Tantor Audio, a division of recorded books, presents Imperial Germany and War, 1871 to 1918, by Daniel J. Hughes and Richard L. DiNardo. Narrated by Nigel Patterson. Preface. From the Wars of German Unification, 1864 to 1871, to the present time, the German army has been one of the most widely studied, criticized, and imitated military organizations in the modern world. In forging the United Germany that emerged in 1871, the Prussian army created new military and political realities in Europe. The new Imperial German military establishment was really a combination of the militaries of Bavaria, Saxony, Württemberg, and Prussia, but the core of the organization was certainly provided by Prussia. Some authors still refer to the Prusso-German military system. The Prussian War Ministry and the Great General Staff exercised considerable influence in domestic politics. War planning was almost exclusively the province of the General Staff. The military effectiveness of the Prussian army system was beyond doubt in 1871, and other military establishments sought to imitate the Prussians, in form, if not in substance. Based on this reputation, the German army seemed equally formidable as the First World War began. The military collapse in 1918 brought the end of the German Empire, but did not end the army's role in domestic politics, as it assisted in establishing both the Weimar Republic and Adolf Hitler's dictatorship. The army's reputation for military effectiveness, however, especially at the tactical and operational levels of war, remained. That reputation has been somewhat diminished by generations of careful study, both in Germany and elsewhere. Nonetheless, the image of the German army as a force capable of operational and tactical brilliance in both world wars remains strong, especially in the popular imagination and even in professional military circles. Because of the army's role in establishing one line of military theory and practice, scholars in a variety of disciplines, from 1871 to the present day, have addressed the German military experience from their varying perspectives. Military thinkers, historians, officers, and defense professionals have examined German systems in the context of the continuing need to prepare military forces for large-scale conventional warfare. German concepts of the conduct of warfare, leadership, command, combat effectiveness, organization, and other topics have been suggestive in shaping military structures and methods. The rise of air power and the development of nuclear weapons had their effects on the conduct of land warfare, but they did not render the German system entirely irrelevant. This volume is an institutional study of the most essential components of the German system between 1871 and 1918. It examines various foundational areas, such as theory, doctrine, institutional structures, training, and the officer corps. The major focus of this work is adaptation and change. The army had to adapt and change in the face of rapid technological developments, while also trying to figure out what a future war would look like and planning for it. Doctrinal changes in the pre-1914 period were often manifested in subtle ways, usually in the form of slight revisions in successive editions of the manuals that shaped the army's tactics. A detailed examination of these modifications is necessary, as a series of minor changes over time can add up to a major change. In war planning, there was one major shift in German thinking about how to conduct a future war in the period between 1871 and 1914. After that, alterations in war plans and mobilization schedules were made subtly and to provide flexibility for the army. The need for adaptation and change only increased after 1914, when theory and doctrine met the reality of modern warfare and was found wanting in a number of respects. Although this study considers battles and campaigns, occasionally in some detail, they are not the primary focus and are discussed mainly in the context of institutional adaptation and change. The German army in this period reflected the federal nature of the German Empire, and thus consisted of four state armies, those of Prussia, Bavaria, Saxony, and Württemberg. The King of Prussia, who also held the position of German Emperor, was the unifying individual under the German Constitution of 1871. The Prussian army was by far the largest of the four state contingents and dominated all aspects of the army's training and doctrine. Domestically, the Prussian army remained what it had always been, a royal army dedicated to the Prussian state's conservative and monarchical social structure. These two fundamental aspects of the army's identity played important roles in determining its social and political place in modern Germany, but they also substantially influenced its internal workings in everything, from officer selection and training to tactics and command, from the lowest to the highest levels. The army was, in short, a bulwark against the emperor's internal opponents, as well as Germany's foreign enemies and rivals. As noted earlier, this volume focuses on theory and practice leading up to the First World War, and on the variety of adaptations that became necessary as the war progressed. The army struggled to adjust to the dichotomous nature of warfare between 1914 and 1917. Trench warfare on the Western Front forced the army to abandon many of its fundamental pre-war principles and practices. The almost constant presence of the German High Command on the Western Front introduced the practice of micromanagement to a degree that senior field commanders found severely constraining. On the Eastern Front and in the Balkans, however, traditional approaches in tactics, operations, and command remained relatively intact. More favourable force-to-space ratios and less capable enemies allowed the army to attain major, but not decisive, victories within its traditional methodological framework. In preparation for the desperate final offensives of 1918, the army's leadership faced the necessity of retraining its tactical units to return to the kind of mobile warfare, Bewegungskrieg, it had prepared for in 1871 to 1914. This was no easy task, as years of trench warfare, Stellungskrieg, in the West, and massive casualties had robbed the army of leaders and units experienced in these traditional methods. Ultimately, the purpose of this work can be stated simply: to provide a comprehensive examination of the army of the Kaiserreich as an institution. This aim is also reflected in the chronological scope of the work, which covers the entire history of the German Empire. Thus, although there are some allusions to them, there is no extended discussion or analysis of the wars of unification from which the empire arose. Likewise, although some attention is paid to the empire's military institutions when they were still in an embryonic state in Prussia during the early 19th century, a detailed discussion of that period of Prussian history is beyond the scope of this work. We hope this work gains the attention not only of those with an interest in the Great War, but also of those listeners who are drawn to the broader history of Germany's imperial era. Before beginning our examination, some explanation is in order. First, names in this volume are rendered in the German version rather than the English. Thus, the German Emperor in 1914 is referred to as Wilhelm II, not William II. Likewise, this volume uses German place names as they existed in 1914. For example, the capital of Austrian Galicia is Lemberg, as opposed to Lvov, Russian or Polish, or Lviv, Ukrainian. This practice applies to general officer ranks as well. Thus, a Generalmajor is equivalent to an American one-star general, and a Generalleutnant would have two stars if the Germans used such a system. Other common German terms also appear in the text, for the sake of simplicity and consistency with the documents and literature on which this study is based. Chapter 1. The Mid-19th Century Foundations. On the 16th of June 1871, the city of Berlin, capital of the new German Empire, played host to one of the greatest military parades in its history. The occasion was the end of the successful war against France and the creation of the German Empire under Prussian domination. This, the third of the Wars of Unification, was the historic high point of the Prussian army, which over the next 40 years reaped the rewards of its great victories. The parade was a symbolic end of the old era in Prussia and the beginning of the Imperial or Wilhelmine period of modern Germany. At the head of his glittering military machine rode Wilhelm I, King of Prussia and German Emperor. Behind him came one of the most popular men in Prussia, indeed in all of Germany, Helmut von Moltke, chief of the Prussian General Staff and architect of the victorious campaigns in Bohemia and France. Behind him marched the elite of the Prussian army, the Guards infantry and cavalry, and many of the army's future leaders. In troubled cooperation with Bismarck, the army had created the New Reich in three victorious campaigns against Denmark, 1864, Austria and its German allies, 1866, and France, 1870-1871. In addition to creating the military foundation of the new empire, Moltke's victories served to legitimize the Prussian army's theories and philosophy of war, elements of which endured in a variety of armies until the last decade of the 20th century. Bismarck's empire offered a political solution to the question of German unification, but only within a framework that by its nature resisted many of the forces that gave rise to Germany's growing wealth and power. This Prussian solution, unification from above rather than from below, and therefore conservative rather than democratic, created a federal state resting on the closely related foundations of monarchical government, military force, and the psychological consequences of the wildly popular victory over France. Prussia thus entered the new era in a manner that left its traditional social structure and its monarchical political structure intact. The aristocracy retained its power base and its ideology. The state therefore represented the powerful forces that sought to control or even destroy the forces of political and social modernization. The Royal Prussian Army. The army remained a primarily royal institution under the new German constitution. Its officers and men retained their traditional oaths to the King of Prussia, whose legitimacy as commander rested in the traditional power and authority of the Prussian monarchy, rather than in the Prussian constitution of 1850 or the German constitution of 1871. In the entire army, only a single officer, the war minister, took an oath of loyalty to the Prussian constitution. Military conventions concluded between Prussia and many of the other states of the German Empire incorporated the smaller contingents directly into the Prussian army, or imposed its structural and doctrinal framework on them. Although Bavaria, Saxony, and Württemberg retained their state armies, the Prussian system dominated in almost every aspect, especially in theory and structure of the armed forces. The Prussian army's foundations lay in its traditional role in shaping and defending Prussia's monarchy and social order, dating to the days of the Great Elector, 1640-1688, and King Friedrich Wilhelm I, 1713-1740. The former made the army the fundamental pillar of the state, while the latter permanently drew Prussia's landed nobility into military service as officers. The Prussian army thereafter served two major functions. It was, perhaps most obviously, the state's primary means of survival and expansion. Less obviously today, the army was the guarantor of the Hohenzollern monarchy's power and of the illiberal rule of Prussia's upper classes. The army's organization reflected its aristocratic and monarchical character. Three institutions played key roles in shaping the army's structure, personnel system, and way of war. These were, respectively, the War Ministry, the Military Cabinet, and the General Staff. The strong and sometimes eccentric personalities that dominated the army from 1871 to 1918 did so within the framework of these three institutions. The War Ministry. The Prussian War Ministry was created as part of the Stein-Hardenberg efforts to reform the Prussian state after its military defeat at the hands of Napoleon in 1806 and its subsequent collapse. The key military reformer was Gerhard von Scharnhorst, 1756 to 1813, who led the Military Reform Commission established by King Friedrich Wilhelm III in July 1807. As part of the effort to introduce the principle of ministerial responsibility in the military arena, the Commission gained royal approval to create what later became known as the War Ministry on the 15th of July 1808. Scharnhorst's goal was to centralise responsibility for all military affairs under the War Ministry, which accordingly had two main departments, the General War Department, Allgemeine Kriegsdepartement, and the Military Administration Department, Militaire Economie Department. The War Ministry would thus unify administration, campaign planning, and personnel affairs under a single responsible cabinet secretary. The reformers immediately encountered the two enduring problems of bureaucratic rationalization of the Prussian military system. The first was the issue of the king's authority as supreme commander of the army, Kommandogewalt. No king was willing to compromise on this, either by creating a single official to administer all military affairs, or, even worse from the royal point of view, by allowing any popular body to interfere in the exercise of this authority. The royal edict of 1808 establishing the War Ministry thus did not give that office command of the field army during wartime, a responsibility that in theory remained a personal function of the monarch until the collapse in 1918. Friedrich Wilhelm III, faced with this problem, declined to appoint a war minister until 1814, when Hermann von Boyen, a relatively liberal reformer, became the first person to hold that office. The second issue that remained problematic throughout the remaining century of the Hohenzollern rule in Prussia was that of direct access, Immediatvortrag, to the king. Even as the war minister began to assume control over nearly all military functions, the commanding generals, corps commanders, retained the right to report directly to the king, and by 1900, several dozen high-ranking positions had acquired that privilege. As a practical matter, the army always lacked any unified control beyond the person of the monarch. The War Ministry's General War Department, headed initially by Scharnhorst, was in theory responsible for the most important matters related to command, while the Military Administration Department dealt with administrative affairs. The General War Department had three main subordinate sections for personnel affairs, general staff functions, and weapons and related issues. The first of these departments was particularly problematic because it managed the most sensitive issue in the entire Prussian system. From the point of view of the monarch and the aristocracy, nothing was more critical than selecting, promoting, assigning, and dismissing or retiring officers. The Military Cabinet. This office, initially known as the Section for the Administration of Personnel Affairs, was later officially designated the Military Cabinet, and it is known to history by that name. The origins of this shadowy institution lay in the early 18th century and the king's Generaladjutants, who administered various official duties involving sensitive, important, or secret matters. From the beginning, the head of the Department for Personnel Affairs was also an adjutant to the king. He thus had direct access to the monarch, even though he was a subordinate of the war minister. For the period between 1814 and 1857, most correspondence and decisions related to personnel matters went through the various war ministers, who were unwilling to exert themselves in sensitive personnel decisions or to challenge the right of their subordinates to report directly to the king. Following the revolution of 1848 to 1849 and the creation of the Prussian Constitution of 1850, the struggle to emancipate the military cabinet from the war ministry began in earnest. This process originated in 1857, when King Friedrich Wilhelm IV, who ruled from 1840 to 1859, ordered that all directors of the Department for Personnel Affairs be chosen exclusively from his personal adjutants or from generals attached to his personal entourage. Edwin von Manteuffel, who headed both the Department for Personnel Affairs and the Military Cabinet from February 1857 through June 1865, used his position as General Adjutant to bypass the War Minister, who gradually lost control over personnel actions. This continued until the 18th of January 1861, when a cabinet order gave the head of the department the right to conduct his business, issue orders, and render personnel decisions without the approval of the War Minister, who thus formally lost all ministerial responsibility for these actions. Subsequent war ministers, especially Julius von Verdi du Vernoy, April 1889 to October 1890, attempted to rein in the chief of the military cabinet, but to no avail. A very small number of individuals, usually fewer than 10 officers and about a dozen civil servants, thus controlled the vast majority of the army's decisions related to officer personnel. In 1861, the military cabinet received authorization to publish personnel actions without the formal approval of the war minister. The military cabinet's responsibilities were defined as the execution of all highest royal orders in assignments, promotions, retirement, pay, punishment, granting of awards, permission to marry, and dismissals of officers and officer candidates. Only the direst circumstances could force the king to subordinate the military cabinet to any other military authority. In the spring of 1918, such a moment arrived when Erich Ludendorff's power was sufficient to cause the removal of the chief of the military cabinet, but not for reasons of personnel administration. For all practical purposes, from 1860 until the end of the monarchy, the military cabinet made nearly all personnel decisions in a secret and frequently arbitrary manner, with no oversight except by the king himself. As a result, the chief of the military cabinet became the most powerful person in the army, second only to the king, and he was capable of intimidating officers at all levels, active or reserve. He was therefore the most feared person in the army, perhaps in all of Prussia or even all of Germany. The resulting witticisms and complaints about the cabinet's arbitrary decisions had no impact on the chief's authority. Wie Gott will und Albedil, as God and Albedil wills, was the saying used to describe the reign of terror when Emil von Albedil held the office, April 1872 to August 1888. Another officer remarked that anyone who lacked personal connections with important men in the military cabinet had to trust his fate to the mercy of his beloved God. In 1870, the chief of the military cabinet was powerful enough to assign officers to Prince Friedrich Karl's staff and subordinate units with complete disregard of the prince's desires. The military cabinet, which had no role in planning or conducting campaigns, made the appointments to key command positions, sometimes with the approval of the general staff, but sometimes against its recommendations. On the whole, however, the chief of the general staff could assign his officers as he wished. Nevertheless, even Count von Schlieffen could not prevail in making general staff assignments if the military cabinet was determined to resist his requested appointments. Finally, in 1883, a royal order completely emancipated the military cabinet's personnel functions from the war ministry. This served to shield the military cabinet from both the Prussian Parliament and the Reichstag. From 1893 onward, the military cabinet also had a very influential role in officer personnel affairs in Württemberg's army. It was small wonder that the army's enemies in the Reichstag referred to the military cabinet as antediluvian and absolutism in its clearest form. Despite consistent criticism from political parties in the Reichstag, the army made no secret of its desire to preserve royal control over all personnel matters. In 1909, the war minister, the ultra-conservative general Karl von Einem, vigorously defended the process in the Reichstag, thus formally and officially reversing the position taken by Scharnhorst and the Military Reform Commission. Despite the secrecy and arbitrary action inherent in the process, many officers regarded it as necessary in a royal army such as Prussia's. The General Staff. The third of the three key institutions of the Prussian army was the General Staff. Although the earliest origins of the Prussian General Staff can arguably be traced to about 1655, its modern history began in 1802. In January and November of that year, Colonel Christian von Massenbach proposed the establishment of a permanent staff that in peacetime would plan for various eventualities that might arise. Shortly thereafter, in 1803, King Friedrich Wilhelm III ordered the reorganization of the Quartermaster General's staff into the General Staff and made Lieutenant General von Geusau its first chief. As Geusau was nearly 70 years old and distracted by other duties, his three key assistants, the most notable of whom was Scharnhorst, did most of the work. Although the General Staff was largely in place in 1806, it could not save the Prussian army from the French army under Napoleon. Nevertheless, many important figures in the future development of the General Staff performed well enough to survive with their reputations intact, including Scharnhorst, Müffling, Valentini, Röhle von Lilienstern, and Boyen. In July 1807, the reform process began in earnest, and Scharnhorst became chief of the General Staff, then still called the Quartermaster General's Staff. He remained in that capacity until August 1813, when he was succeeded by August Wilhelm von Gneisenau, one of his close associates in the Reform Party. Massenbach, largely discredited as a field soldier by his actions at Prenzlau, had no opportunity to implement his ideas, which had always taken second place to those of Scharnhorst. The latter's memorandum of 1808 established the wartime composition of the General Staff as one colonel, four majors, eight captains, and 12 lieutenants. Both Gneisenau and Scharnhorst were thus key in establishing the basic features of the General Staff system, which lasted well into the Second World War. The General Staff officially received that designation on the 20th of June 1817. As previously noted, Scharnhorst successfully implemented his proposal that the chief of the General Staff become a subordinate of the War Minister. He further proposed that the General Staff adopt a functional organization with four sections: strategy and tactics, internal administration, replacements, and artillery and munitions. Although opposition from conservatives prevented the full implementation of his plan, the General Staff played a key role in the final campaigns against Napoleon. Scharnhorst in those years established the fundamental principle that the General Staff officer, at whatever level he functioned, should remain in the background, giving the commander advice and support without limiting the commander's authority or tarnishing his image with subordinates and the troops at large. When Scharnhorst died of complications from a wound suffered at Großgürschen, Gneisenau took his place as chief of the General Staff. Gneisenau's contributions to the ethos and methods of the General Staff were nearly as important as Scharnhorst's. Gneisenau emphasized clarity in communications, brevity, and reliance on general directives rather than detailed orders. He also developed the concept of joint responsibility, which, though unwritten, remained one of the fundamental pillars of the General Staff system until Hitler abolished it in the Second World War. Under this principle, the General Staff officer assumed responsibility for his commander's decisions. Thus, the officer's evaluation was in part dependent on the performance and fate of the commander he advised. Eventually, the army accorded its General Staff officers the right to register a dissenting opinion in the unit's war diary, if they had strongly advised the commander against a particular course of action. Joint responsibility did not mean joint or shared command, however. The Prussian army, throughout its long history, recognized only a single commander in any given unit. So firm was the resolve not to dilute the authority of the commander that the Prussian army never established positions such as deputy or vice commander, as had been the practice in many other armies. From 1815 until its growth in power and prestige during the Wars of Unification, 1864 to 1871, The general staff functioned in difficult circumstances, but continued to establish the basic procedures that laid the foundation for its later glory. From the outset, the general staff had two elements. The Großer Generalstab, Great General Staff, in Berlin, worked directly under the chief of the general staff on the centralized functions assigned to it by the War Ministry. Other general staff officers, collectively known as the Truppengeneralstab, general staff in the units, served as chiefs of staff and primary advisers to corps commanders, and intermittently until 1853, division commanders. These officers worked directly for their units' commanders, but remained general staff officers in every sense. The two groups were part of the same select body of general staff officers, and any individual might find himself in either group at any given time. Most officers rotated consistently, but with substantial variation among the great general staff, the unit general staff, and normal command assignments at levels appropriate to their rank. This practice had the dual purposes of providing trained advisers to large unit commanders and ensuring that the general staff did not stagnate and become a military ivory tower out of touch with developments in the army. This remained standard practice until the end of the Second World War. The general staff was not a particularly important or vibrant institution for much of the period between 1815 and the arrival of Helmut von Moltke in 1857. It lost much of its royal support and vitality as the reformers declined in influence or left the army. Its assigned officer strength declined from 69 at the beginning of the post-war period to a mere 24 in 1824. The divisions lost their general staff officers that year, creating a gap that lasted almost 30 years. For the next three decades, the general staff performed its work in the shadow of the War Ministry. Its chiefs accepted this subordinate position. The general staff had limited direct influence on the army's training, doctrinal manuals, weapons development, and related areas, and the war minister continued to exercise his authority through ad hoc commissions to deal with specific issues as they arose. The results of the mobilization of 1850 demonstrated that neither the army nor its general staff was prepared to deal with a serious military crisis. Although the Prussian general staff had several influential chiefs in the first half of the 19th century, the decisive personality in establishing the general staff's position for the period covered by this study was Helmut von Moltke. When Moltke became chief of the general staff in 1857, that body was but a minor element of the war ministry, responsible for only a fraction of the duties and functions later associated with it. This quiet but effective chief gradually extended his involvement in these and many other areas. In 1858, the general staff gained control over corps staff rides. In 1861, the king extended this authority to the manoeuvres of large units. Of even greater importance, in 1858 Moltke ordered the general staff to use railroads for large exercises in peacetime, and in 1859 he instituted the extensive coordination between the army and the Prussian railway system that became the foundation of Prussia's speedy and efficient mobilizations in 1866, 1870, and 1914. The size of the general staff increased as Moltke extended its influence. When Moltke became chief, the general staff had fewer than 65 officers, and only about 20 of them were in Berlin. By 1900, the general staff had nearly 300 officers, more than 100 of whom served in the central staff in Berlin. The number of fully qualified general staff officers was greater, since at any one time some of them were commanding units at various levels or serving on special assignments. Between 1900 and 1914, the general staff doubled its strength, growing to about 650 officers. About 150 of them worked in the main sections dealing with mobilization, strategic planning, intelligence, education and training, fortresses, military history, and so forth. Standing army, or citizen soldiers. The nature of the army's use of manpower and its unit structure were just as important as the high command structures discussed previously. The revolutionary changes in society and warfare brought about by the French Revolution forced Prussia to reduce its reliance on the lowest classes of society and foreigners to fill its enlisted ranks. To a limited degree, the monarchy had, unwillingly but of necessity, enlisted the resources of the entire state in the final struggles against Napoleon after 1812. The military reformers had hoped, like the French, to create a revitalized nation of citizens rather than subjects, and in the military realm, an army of citizens who would support the state out of commitment rather than the coercion that had characterized the army of the Ancien Régime. To that end, Prussia emerged from the Napoleonic Wars with a relatively small active army and a substantial body of citizen soldiers, the Landwehr, with elected officers and relatively independent units of marginally trained civilians. The army's unit structure, like so many other aspects of its development, thus went back to the reforms of Scharnhorst and his colleagues. The long struggle over the Prussian Landwehr and the effort to create a viable system of reserve forces illustrate the difficulties the Prussian army faced in reconciling the potentially conflicting demands of military effectiveness and political reliability. The Landwehr issue first arose during the dark days between the battles of Jena-Auerstedt and the final victories over Napoleon. The reformers hoped to combine the principle of universal military service with a reserve army of citizen soldiers. Scharnhorst hoped to use these two innovations to bind the army more closely to the population and to preserve a democratic base within the army. Royal decrees established the principle of universal service on the 9th of February 1813 and instituted the Landwehr on the 17th of March of that year. The latter decree broadened the similar steps already taken by the provincial diet in East Prussia after General York von Wartenburg deserted Napoleon and joined the advancing Russians to drive the hated French out of Prussia and Germany. The Landwehr was not the only effort to draw the great mass of the population directly into the twin efforts to unite people and nation and to eject the French from Prussia. When mobilized, the Landwehr would be part of the regular army, with appropriate pay, discipline, and administrative arrangements. Scharnhorst also proposed a second line of reserves, the Landsturm, to be composed of all physically fit citizens. These reserves would engage in guerrilla warfare against the enemy, like the Spaniards had done in 1808. To be used only as a last resort, the Landsturm was not expected to have military discipline or administrative arrangements. Its members, moreover, would be organised and used without regard to social origins. A royal decree on the 12th of April 1813 officially established the Landsturm. From the outset, the Landwehr and the Landsturm were controversial because they threatened the layering of Prussian society, and because many conservatives were fearful of the long-term consequences of arming the population. In the spring of 1814, Hermann von Boyen became Prussian war minister and began the task of creating a long-term peacetime army, including reserve forces. Boyen soon came up with a plan that reaffirmed the principle of universal military service and assigned all able-bodied men to one of four sections of Prussia's armed forces: the active army, the Landwehr of the first and second levies, and the Landsturm. The Landwehr of the first levy was to conduct limited peacetime drills and serve alongside regular forces during wartime. The Landwehr of the second levy, consisting of veterans of the regular army and of the first Landwehr levy, was to perform garrison duties in wartime. The Landsturm was to be an emergency mobilisation of all men between the ages of 17 and 50 not serving in the other three military forces. The new law also established the principle of the one-year volunteer, which became the backbone of the state's reserve forces and one of the main elements linking Prussia's upper classes and educated middle classes with the army and the monarchy. Boyen and the other reformers saw the Landwehr as an institution that would bind people and army together and create a citizen-based officer corps as a balance to the aristocratic and conservative officers of the active army. Thus, the Landwehr was to consist of coherent and independent units, rather than serve as a source of individual replacements for the active army. Boyen wished to ensure that the Landwehr officer corps, in large part elected by local units, would train its own units and command them upon mobilisation. The original plan called for mixing three Landwehr and three active battalions in a wartime brigade. Boyen's proposals became law on the 3rd of September 1814. Unfortunately, the statute was very vague and required additional implementing legislation and regulations, which gave conservative opponents an opportunity to dilute its effects. The debate over the desirability and effectiveness of such a reserve system continued unabated through the next several decades, and foreshadowed many of the disputes over the great military reforms of 1860. Conservatives attacked the idea of separating the line from reserve forces on political and military grounds. Those who opposed universal military service saw the Landwehr as an unreliable force of dubious value to the active army in wartime, and one that might turn against the monarchy in a crisis. Prominent officers, from princes of the royal house to powerful figures such as Job von Witzleben, warned of the consequences of Boyen's reforms. Civilian liberals, in contrast, saw the Landwehr and its middle-class officer corps as the only counterweight to the noble officers of the army. In a similar vein, others saw the Landwehr officer as the only guarantee for the citizens' spirit in the army. In the years between 1815 and 1860, the Landwehr encountered many difficulties in finding capable officers and forming effective forces, even at the company level. Landwehr officers came almost entirely from very poorly trained one-year volunteers, a problem made worse by the relatively small size of the active army and the departure of officers who had experience in the Wars of Liberation. Numerous observers warned that the Landwehr's officer-related problems naturally extended to the unit's overall capabilities. Prussia's failure to implement universal military service deprived the Landwehr of a sufficient number of experienced soldiers to replace those who left. Shortages of funds only made these fundamental problems worse. Between the end of the Napoleonic period and the Horn reforms of 1859 to 1860, the Landwehr had several opportunities to either prove its worth or demonstrate the correctness of its critics. In each case, its performance confirmed that it was of marginal value as a military force. In 1831, Prussia mobilized part of its forces, including some reserves, because of the Polish uprising, and it did the same in 1832 because of the French invasion of Belgium. Each mobilization revealed numerous weaknesses, and the Landwehr was no exception. From the king's point of view, the Landwehr's performance during the Revolution of 1848 was, if anything, even worse, and this was especially true of the officer corps. The Landwehr units, which turned out to be weak militarily, all too frequently were less than reliable politically. The Landwehr made, in the words of one distinguished historian, a lamentable showing. Further mobilizations in 1850 and 1859 showed little, if any, improvement. These weaknesses were related to both officers and units, and to military as well as political issues. Many Landwehr officers were too old, even by Prussian standards. Some units had company-level officers who were up to 49 years old, and the average age in 1848 was 47 for captains and 39 for first lieutenants, even in the combat units. Despite their long years of reserve duty, many had not improved on their inadequate training prior to commissioning, a problem related partly to the government's unwillingness to provide adequate financial support, but also to the poor structure of training and the lack of practical exercises. The Landwehr's non-commissioned officers exhibited tremendous shortcomings in training and capabilities. The army found, as many conservative officers had warned during the reform period, that it could not rely on the Landwehr for use in either foreign wars or domestic revolution. By the end of these sobering experiences, Prussia had acquired a new king and an aggressively conservative war minister, both bent on a thoroughgoing reform of the army's basic structure and its officer corps. The Hun Reform of 1860. In October 1858, Prince Wilhelm of Prussia assumed the regency in place of his brother, King Friedrich Wilhelm IV, who had suffered a complete mental collapse. Though a royal prince, Wilhelm had been a real officer for decades. A die-hard conservative, he had been forced to flee to England during the revolutions of 1848 to 1849. He was determined to effect a major change in the army, and in October 1857, while not yet officially the regent, he requested the war ministry to prepare a proposal to deal with the deficiencies revealed by the recent crises and mobilizations. The war minister, Count Friedrich von Waldersee, responded with a memorandum dealing primarily with changes in the conscription system, an expansion of the army, and a reduced reliance on Landwehr soldiers to fill out active units during mobilization, while maintaining the 2-year service obligation for conscripts. Prince Wilhelm also asked for a reform proposal from his old friend Count Albrecht von Roon, then commanding an infantry division in Posen. Roon's reply, one of the most important documents in Prussian military history, became the basis of what is known as the Roon Reforms of 1860. Most historians have seen these reforms primarily as military efforts to improve the army's ability to mobilize its forces and to wage war, despite the fact that they clearly strengthened the monarchical and conservative nature of the army. Roon, no doubt, was equally interested in the external and domestic significance of his concepts. The essential features of these complicated proposals were a moderate increase in the standing army, the abolition of the Landwehr as established by Napoleonic-era reformers, the creation of a new reserve system, and the introduction of a 3-year term of service for most conscripts. Roon saw the Landwehr as one of the main roots of the army's problems. It was, he wrote, a politically false institution, because it no longer impressed foreign powers and was of doubtful significance for both external and internal policy. It was, he went on, equally false on military grounds, because it lacked the firm soldier's spirit and the certain disciplinary control necessary in a dependable military organism. Roon proposed a substantially new basis for the army by ensuring that the active army and its officer corps were firmly in control of the state's armed forces, and that these forces possessed an organization that could effectively organize the nation's resources for war. In 1860, the army enacted this great reform proposal as Roon became war minister. New reserve units, up to corps size in wartime, became the primary second-line military force. The Landwehr, as a semi-independent force primarily loyal to the middle-class strata of society, disappeared completely. Roon replaced it with reserve units that were an extension of the active army. These new reserve units, commanded by regular officers from the rank of major upward, would take the field with the active-duty army. The younger groups of the Landwehr entered the new reserve units, while the older reservists became members of the downgraded Landwehr. The latter, along with the Landsturm, consisting of the oldest men still eligible for military duty, was intended only to perform garrison duty in rear areas. Introduction of the 3-year service commitment and an overall increase in the size of the active army produced more trained enlisted men for the reserve units. Although the Prussian Parliament refused to approve the army's budget, the king continued to command the army independently of any parliamentary or other governmental limitations, ignoring the fact that in theory no funds were available. During the great constitutional conflict between 1860 and 1866, The king and his chancellor, Otto von Bismarck, ruled without a budget when the Prussian parliament refused to grant annual appropriations because of its hostility to Roon's reform programme. Using his constitutional gap theory, Bismarck simply announced that the government would continue to collect taxes and provide funds for the army. After the victorious war against Austria, the parliament conceded the government's right to conduct the army's business in this manner. The shadow of this confrontation, based on the king's right to command the army, Kommandogewalt, hung ominously over subsequent discussions of the military budget. After 1870, when the military budget became an imperial matter, the practice of granting multi-year appropriations, frequently for 7 years in advance, effectively limited all but the most determined criticism of the army. While great controversies arose in subsequent years over the size of the army, neither the Prussian Parliament nor the German Reichstag ever seriously challenged the king's right to command the army as he saw fit. As a result, many measures that would require parliamentary sanction in a democracy rested solely on orders of the king. The parliaments of Prussia and Germany had no voice in critical personnel matters or in internal army affairs, such as doctrine and unit structure. The Roon reforms changed the structure of the army in several less controversial ways. The final version increased the mobilized strength of the field army by some 32,000 officers and men, from about 335,000 to 367,000. Total wartime strength, including replacement and fortress units, rose from approximately 532,000 to 637,000. The active officer corps grew by about 1,200 to a total of 8,000. To overcome the resulting shortages, the army allowed selected Landwehr officers to join active units and shortened the courses of senior cadets and officer candidates in the war schools. At the end of the reform, the active army had 81 regiments of infantry and 40 of cavalry. Finally, it should be noted that after the reforms, the active Prussian army was basically an army of cadre units, a mobilization base to bring substantial elements of the citizenry into existing units upon mobilization. Active units were not at full strength in peacetime. They relied on reservists, all of whom had previously served 2 or 3 years on active duty, to reach wartime strength. Active officers commanded the new reserve units above the company level, and in some cases at that echelon. The highest reserve rank was captain, and all reserve officers and officers of the new Landwehr, a second-line reserve force relegated to rear area duty, had previously passed through the active army. The old Landwehr officer corps ceased to exist. All officers therefore had active or reserve commissions conferred through the regular army. All this put the officer corps on the path it would follow with few exceptions or changes until the outbreak of war in 1914. Most historians agree that King Wilhelm I pressed for the reforms primarily to bolster his army and state against potential rivals in European power politics, rather than to mount an attack against his internal political enemies. However, the reforms certainly bound the bulk of Prussia's armed forces more closely to the monarch, and promised to make the reserve officers and their units more reliable in case of a political crisis, a fact that the opposition political parties clearly recognised at the time. The officer corps. Ideology. The Prussian army proudly displayed its conservative ideology on numerous political and social questions. This basic orientation survived the fall of the monarchy and remained intact until the rapid expansion of the army prior to the Second World War, when the substantial influx of young officers with a strong National Socialist orientation reduced traditional Prussian conservatives to isolated segments of the high officer corps. This conservative worldview had a definite impact on the army's approach to war and its relation to Prussian and German society. The key to this conservatism was the officer corps and its ideology, recruitment process, and social position. As previously mentioned, Officers took an oath to the King of Prussia rather than to any written constitution or set of basic national values beyond those traditionally associated with the Hohenzollern monarchy. This link to the Hohenzollerns was the basis of the officer corps' homogeneity and exclusivity. Prussian monarchs realized that the army and its officer corps were the ultimate guarantors of their positions. Friedrich Wilhelm IV stated this unequivocally when he said that his army was the necessary condition of the existence of the throne. In a similar, almost prophetic vein, Bismarck once reminded Wilhelm II that as long as he had his officer corps, he could do anything he wished, but should this cease to be the case, the entire situation would be different. The officer corps, for its part, developed an allegiance to the monarchy that transcended the temporary lack of respect that emerged when kings such as Friedrich Wilhelm IV or Wilhelm II seemed hesitant or less than royal in their conduct or strength of will. Many officers retained their personal loyalty to Wilhelm II even after the disasters of the First World War, when the Kaiser became a passive observer in the shadow of the semi-dictatorship of Hindenburg and Ludendorff. This loyalty to the monarchy began in the cadet corps, which, in the words of one admiring general, sought to instill feelings of awe and respect for the ruling houses, not only of Prussia, but also of other German states and some foreign nations. In return for their unquestioned loyalty, officers were generously rewarded with the prestige reserved for the highest echelons of Prussian society. The army's social standing, moreover, rose substantially during the latter decades of the 19th century, as it basked in the glory of the Wars of Unification. The commissioning process was one of the primary means of ensuring the ideological basis of the officer corps. The army desired educated officers only to the extent that this would reinforce its social basis and produce a sufficient number of officers with the skills necessary to master advances in applied technology and mathematics. The Prussian officer corps was not an educated group by the standards of modern armed forces, although it made important concessions to education over the course of the 19th century. The army wished to establish educational standards that would exclude the sons of lower class families, while admitting the sons of landowners, officers, lower civil servants, and other social groups deemed desirable in the officer corps. Education. Although some have noted improved educational levels after the reform period, for at least the first half of the 19th century, the army was sorely lacking in real educational standards for its officer corps. Even as late as mid-century, numerous sources attest to the presence of many poorly educated men in an army that profited from the presence of Clausewitz, Moltke, and other talented and literate officers. Count Wrangel's boast that he conducted war with the sword and not with the pen found wide endorsement in the army. Efforts by Napoleonic-era reformers to establish rigid examinations to determine eligibility for commissions resulted in an 1808 regulation that affirmed the principles of knowledge and education as fundamental requirements. Nevertheless, conservatives in the army frustrated all efforts to use educational requirements to transform the officer corps. In 1816, the army established division schools to provide rudimentary education for socially acceptable youngsters who aspired to become officers. The curricula of these schools consisted of simple mathematics, a little history and geography, and some German grammar. They had separate classes for students who wished to take the officer candidate examination and for those who hoped to pass the officer examination. Prince Wilhelm, later King and Emperor Wilhelm I, headed a commission in 1825 that recommended the elimination of these miserable excuses for schools and the use of scholarships to enable the sons of poor officers to attend gymnasia. The government did not accept this proposal and allowed semi-literate officer candidates to join the army if they could find regiments to accept them. Subsequent efforts by Boyen to require that all officer candidates possess a certificate of eligibility for higher schooling also failed. The first major step in raising educational levels came in 1854, when the army abolished the division schools, notorious for their low standards. In place of the nine divisions schools, General Eduard von Pücker, the General Inspector of Military Training and Education, established the first three war schools at Neisse, Potsdam and Erfurt. Not to be confused with the Allgemeine Kriegsschule, the old name of the War Academy, these centralized institutions remained key components of the commissioning process until 1914. By the mid-19th century, those who argued for improved educational standards for commissions had begun to make some progress. Pücker's efforts in 1856 to 1857 to impose the Primareife, equivalent to a high school diploma, as the minimal educational requirement failed. But a few years later, the Hohn reforms nearly succeeded on that point. In 1862, Wilhelm I accepted Hohn's proposal in principle, but balked at implementation. This only delayed the inevitable, and in 1870, a cabinet order specified that, after the 1st of April 1872, only those who possessed the Primareife could take the officer candidate examination. The army continued to grant numerous exceptions, however, and many graduates of the shadowy military preparation schools joined the officer corps. In 1899, Wilhelm II ordered a strict enforcement of the Primareife requirement and a reduction in the number of exceptions granted. Nevertheless, between 1902 and 1912, more than 1,000 young men were exempted from this educational prerequisite. In 1900, Wilhelm II, despite his sympathy for maintaining the social homogeneity of the officer corps, approved a regulation granting favourable treatment to young men possessing the Abitur, a 9-year diploma with examinations and theoretical eligibility to attend a university. Those who held the Abitur were exempt from the preliminary officer candidate examination and could bypass the war school course if they proved to be especially capable during the probationary period in their regiments. This caused a gradual improvement in the educational level of the officer corps, and by 1914, about 65% of officer candidates held the Abitur. The army attracted a very respectable proportion of the total number of young men earning the Abitur, between 6 and 7% by 1900. Arriving at an overall assessment of the educational level of the Prussian officer corps is no simple matter. It is almost certainly wrong to argue that the educational level of the officer corps actually declined during the imperial period. Rather, the argument for a gradual improvement seems well-founded, despite the officer corps' shortcomings. The Prussian officer corps in this regard was in no way inferior to most of its European counterparts. The Prussian army had many highly literate officers, and the proportion of its generals who wrote books and published articles in professional journals is one that few modern armies can match. Much of this intellectual activity, but by no means all of it, centred on the elite corps of the Prussian general staff. Although the Prussian officer corps in 1914 was not highly educated by the standards of most professions in Germany, or by the standards of most modern armed forces, neither was it composed of semi-literates at any rank. Still, education remained subordinate to social class and ideological conformity as a measure of a young man's military potential. In this area, as in so many others, the attitude of the elder Moltke typified the army's predominant attitude. In 1871, he reminded the Reichstag that more important than what is learned in school is the subsequent moral education, Erziehung, of the man, his becoming accustomed to order, punctuality, neatness, obedience and loyalty, in short, discipline. It is that discipline that placed our army in a position to win three campaigns. The commissioning process. The army's process of conferring commissions on its young officers clearly illustrated the fundamental social and institutional factors that gave the officer corps its unique position. Most young men, with the exception of cadets, as discussed later, who wished to become officers had to find regiments that were willing to accept them as officer candidates. No central institution served as an induction or commissioning agent. If a regimental commander had vacant positions, and if he were satisfied that the applicant possessed the educational qualifications, social background, and personal characteristics required by the army and his regiment, he had the authority to accept the young man as an officer candidate. The applicant then had to take the officer candidate examination, administered by the Obermilitärprüfungskommission at several sites throughout Prussia, but normally at division headquarters. The candidate then joined his regiment and served as an enlisted soldier in a special rank between sergeant and sergeant major. Although the candidate's duties were much the same as those of a typical enlisted man, his special position separated him from the lower rank and file. Very few Prussian officers actually rose from the ranks. The most notable exception was Karl von Reyer, who served as chief of the general staff from 1848 to 1858. After several months of service in the regiment, the candidate went off to one of the division schools, which were later consolidated into a smaller number of centralized war schools. While there, the candidate took the officer examination and then returned to his regiment for an indefinite period, usually 1 to 3 months, until he received a commission. Before that could happen, the candidate was subjected to the officer's election, whereby all officers of the regiment voted on the candidate's suitability to become an officer. A single negative vote was sufficient to prevent the granting of a commission, although in theory the corps commander had the final word. So ingrained was the concept of the officer's election that it survived, at least in theory, until Hitler abolished it in 1943. Finally, if the regimental commander approved, the young man, after approximately 18 months of duty as an officer candidate, became a second lieutenant. This was the commissioning process experienced by the majority of Prussian officers. Only a few particularly privileged or well-connected men bypassed this system or the other route, the cadet corps. Once commissioned, an officer could be dismissed only by an order of the king. Cadets took a different road to obtain their commissions. Cadets had no choice of unit and had to accept whatever assignment the military cabinet deemed appropriate, based on the needs of the army. Cadets who entered the army after their Oberprima, ninth year, had to follow the same path as non-cadets, but spent fewer months in their units before and after their war school studies. They could receive a commission in about 1 year. The Selektor of the cadet corps, whose extra year gave them the equivalent of the war school diploma as well as the Abitur, entered the army as lieutenants. Social composition. The army that Moltke led to victory in 1866 and 1870 to 1871 was decidedly aristocratic in terms of the social composition of its officer corps, and it remained so at the highest levels throughout the imperial period. An understanding of the ethos of Prussia's military aristocracy is essential to an understanding of its way of war. The reformers had hoped to open the officer corps to all men of talent and education, regardless of wealth or social origin. After the end of the Napoleonic period and the demise of the reformers, reactionaries in the army attempted to restore the aristocratic exclusivity that had traditionally characterized Prussia's officers. Efforts to re-establish the traditional reliance on nobles enjoyed partial success, but were doomed to failure as the Prussian army expanded before and after the Wars of Unification. At the end of the Napoleonic Wars, the officer corps was almost equally divided between nobles and non-nobles. In 1817, the army had 4,138 noble officers and 3,367 commoners. Efforts to purge the wartime officer corps of undesirable elements continued in the following decade, but could not prevent a gradual growth of non-noble elements. In 1860, about 65% of all officers were nobles. As the army expanded under the Roon reforms, and during the gradual increases between 1871 and 1914, the percentage of noble officers fell dramatically. In 1913, only about one officer in three possessed a title of nobility, while the overall size of the officer corps increased from about 17,000 in 1875 to 30,000 immediately before the outbreak of war in 1914. Although certain regiments, particularly the guards and many cavalry units, remained bastions of the aristocracy, non-nobles increasingly dominated the middle and lower officer ranks as the decades passed. Nevertheless, key positions remained in the hands of the aristocracy throughout the life of Bismarck's empire. For the entire imperial period up to the First World War, 1871 to 1914, nearly 70% of all generals were nobles. Likewise, the highest positions in the general staff remained in the hands of the aristocracy throughout the 19th century. More than 8 in 10 general staff generals were nobles, a figure that showed no appreciable change from those appointed by Count Helmut von Moltke to those appointed by Schlieffen and the younger Moltke. At the lower levels of the general staff, the picture was quite different. By 1913, about 70% of the men assigned to the Großer Generalstab were bourgeois, including most of the officers holding key positions as section leaders. Some have cited this as an indication of the growing professionalization of the general staff, a point of undoubted merit. Yet the persistence of the aristocracy in the general staff's highest ranks, not just in the Großer Generalstab, seems to contrast starkly with the growing number of non-nobles among the general staff corps as a whole. It could not have been an accident that so many generals of the general staff, many of whom were also commanders of divisions and corps at some point, were drawn from the nobility. Traditional aristocratic values permeated the intellectual, cultural, and social life of the officer corps. Officers policed their own ranks with courts of honour, Ehrengerichte, and continued to fight duels, in spite of numerous official admonitions and orders to cease this antiquated practice. Officers were expected to maintain a lifestyle appropriate to their station in life, which was quite exalted. All officers, regardless of rank or social class, were eligible to attend court, Hofweg. This privilege was restricted to a tiny minority of the Prussian and German populations, normally nobles and very high-ranking commoners in the civil service. The army carefully examined the backgrounds of officers' potential wives, demanding that their families' occupations, reputations, and, if necessary, wealth be appropriate. The officer corps, in short, was not open to all men of talent. It was open only to men of talent whose social background and personal characteristics were consistent with the army's image of what the king's officers should be. As the 19th century progressed, suitability for the officer corps became primarily a function of a young man's social standing based on his family's occupational background. The Prussian army consistently tried to fill its officer corps with the sons of officers, landowners, and high civil servants. These old Prussian types were most likely to have the personal characteristics and political loyalties necessary for an army that was, after all, a royal institution rather than a broad-based entity that served the population as a whole. Precise determinations of officers' occupational backgrounds are not available, but Karl Demeter's research convincingly suggests that even as late as 1913, these old Prussian types provided the army with more than 70% of its officers. Promotions to the army's highest and most influential positions were even more narrowly confined to old Prussian types. For the empire as a whole, more than 9 out of 10 generals were sons of landowners, officers, or high civil servants, or some combination of these groups. This dominance of old Prussian types was clearly evident among the non-noble generals serving between 1871 and 1914, as nearly 8 in 10 of them were drawn from the same social groups as the noble generals. Among its highest and most influential echelons, the officer corps was remarkably homogeneous, even in 1914. Although much of the specialist and general literature describes the officer corps as Junker, That expression must be used with caution in relation to the Prussian army in the 19th century. Imprecision is a major problem in using the term, which has become a pejorative expression to describe conservative officers and their sinister designs, of which most historians strongly disapprove. In its original meaning, Junker referred primarily to sons of noble East Elbian landowners. Others have broadened the term to include any East Elbian noble. Among the key intellectuals and commanders prominent in the development of the army's theory and doctrine, Junkers were in a distinct minority. Barely half of Prussia's generals were born in the provinces east of the Elbe River, and relatively few of them were sons of landowners. If one assumes a direct connection with the landed East Elbian nobility, fewer than one Prussian general in five was a Junker. Most generals were sons of government professionals, that is, officers or civil servants, without landed connections and without other visible means of support. For the empire as a whole, nearly two generals in three, 65.86%, fell into this category, a proportion that remained reasonably stable between 1871 and 1914. Wealth. The financial circumstances of the officer corps reflected the social structure of Prussia and the prestige of the army in society. Until 1909, the army remunerated its junior officers at a minimal level, assuming that they would use their personal funds to make up the difference between their pay and the sums required to maintain an acceptable lifestyle. The amount of private income needed varied greatly from the guards' units, especially the cavalry, to the regular infantry units. Even in 1914, some of the former required their members to provide hundreds of marks per month to support their horses and entertainment costs, while many officers in ordinary regiments had little or no private income. Young men of wealth and pedigree could find acceptance in the wealthy regiments, while others had to confine their early careers to regiments where the demands on private income were modest. Cavalry regiments were the most expensive, followed by some artillery and a few infantry regiments. Pre-1914 handbooks used the following as a guideline for the monthly requirements of a moderate lifestyle in a typical regiment. Cavalry, 150 marks, artillery, 70, infantry, 45. In comparison, the average German industrial worker in 1913 earned about 25 marks per week. Many officers had little or no private income and survived by living in splendid misery or by acquiring debt during their junior years. A few received special subsidies from the army, the so-called Emperor's Zulage. The net result was that low pay in the junior grades excluded most men from the officer corps. Wealth-based divisions survived even within the officer corps. A number of cavalry regiments became the preserve of wealthy playboys from prosperous aristocratic families. Other cavalry units attracted a mixture of wealthy commoners and aristocrats who could not find positions in the more prestigious regiments. The luxurious lifestyles in these elite units became a major target for the army's political enemies and a source of concern to many senior officers. In the final years before 1914, the war ministry tried to control excessive monetary requirements by individual regiments, but it could not overcome the entrenched resistance and power of regimental commanders. It was thus no accident that the cavalry stubbornly clung to an outmoded vision of its role in warfare, all the way onto the battlefields of 1914. To generalize about a complicated issue, it is safe to say that most officers were not wealthy but had at least an upper-middle-class background. Most had private income of at least a few hundred marks per year, although there were exceptions. The expenses of acquiring the education needed for a military career were far less than those incurred to prepare for other professions in Germany. Young aristocrats in particular found that a military career was an affordable way to maintain their social standing, which could suffer greatly if they chose occupations that lacked respectability. Wealthy young men used their commissions to enhance their social standing far beyond what they might have achieved in most other occupations. the Reserve Officer Corps. While the active army remained under the control of the aristocracy and other old Prussian types, the bulk of its wartime officer strength was in its reserve corps. Upon mobilization, these men constituted the majority of the officers in the reserve and Landwehr units, but they also served in active units in large numbers. After the Rhun reforms, the reserve officer corps consisted exclusively of men who had either been on active duty or served as one-year volunteers before becoming reserve officers upon leaving active duty. The one-year volunteer system, therefore, was one of the pillars of the entire military system. Prior to the Rhun reforms, one-year volunteers went directly into the Landwehr, with little oversight from the active officer corps. This system had its origins in Boyen's invigoration of the Landwehr in 1813 to 1814. After the Rhun reforms, the reserve officer system was much more closely bound to the active army and the oversight of the military cabinet. The reserve officer corps, like its active counterpart, was open only to men who possessed the proper social background, personal characteristics, and financial means to support their station in life. One-year volunteers had to belong to the educated classes, defined as possession of the Sekundareife at a Gymnasium or Oberrealschule, a requirement that intentionally eliminated most sons of the working class and the peasantry. One-year volunteers also had to pay all their own expenses, estimated to be at least 2,000 to 3,000 marks. However, this could be much more in some locations and in the mounted branches. One-year volunteers paid for their uniforms, quarters, food, military equipment, enlisted servants, and in some cases, horses and fodder. At a time when an ordinary semi-skilled worker might have had an annual income of 1,000 to 1,300 marks, only the educated middle classes could afford to use the one-year system as a way to avoid duty as a common soldier. A very small number of especially desirable candidates, at most 0.1% in Prussia, received state support. To continue service as a reserve officer, one had to possess an annual income of at least 1,200 marks. This figure rose to 1,800 marks for men who were married. These requirements were beyond the means of the majority of even those with the requisite education. One-year volunteers made a substantial contribution to the strength of the army and saved it a lot of money. In the 1870s, about 7,000 men served in that capacity in a given year, but by 1914 the number had risen to between 14,000 and 16,000. Most of this growth took place after 1899, as the army began to expand and a shortage of officers afflicted some of the active regiments. Many other former one-year volunteers served as reserve non-commissioned officers and enlisted men. A reasonably reliable estimate is that 200,000 former one-year volunteers were still reporting for annual training in 1905. One-year volunteers could choose their active duty regiments, where they served in middle positions between normal enlisted men and non-commissioned officers. Here they enjoyed a leisurely year or suffered substantial abuse at the hands of their non-commissioned officers, depending on which account one chooses to believe. Their experiences could not have been too terrible, however, as many chose to attain reserve commissions and remain in the reserves in one capacity or another. At the termination of his year of active duty, the volunteer's unit passed judgment on his eligibility to continue as an applicant for a reserve commission. Just prior to the First World War, the active army gave certificates of eligibility to just under half the one-year volunteers. Those who were not eligible continued to serve as enlisted men in their reserve units until their service obligation was completed. Eligible men who were interested in receiving reserve commissions applied to district commands, Bezirkskommandos, which oversaw reserve officers in their respective regions of Prussia. If accepted as officer candidates, they served for two periods of active duty over the following 2 years as non-commissioned officers, and took a fairly rigorous examination on military subjects. If they passed, they served 2 additional periods of active duty, performing officer duties in their reserve or active units. The district commanders and the reserve officers of the districts passed final judgment on a candidate's suitability to wear the king's uniform, although, of course, the military cabinet also had a voice. Between 1877 and 1909, a Prussian army order governed the factors to be considered in granting such commissions. In 1909, it was clear that the districts had been sufficiently rigorous in enforcing the army's social and military standards that such centralized supervision was no longer necessary. Acting on a request by the Bavarian War Ministry, the Prussian War Ministry withdrew the 1877 order. District commanders carefully examined candidates' private lives and police records, and questioned former school directors and other sources that would be useful in determining the acceptability of officer candidates, who, in the words of a popular handbook for potential officers, had to possess a stainless character. The army took care to exclude those who had been active in the Social Democratic Party, and, in most but not all cases, Jews. Most reserve officers were sons of the educated middle class and had solid civilian occupations themselves. Unlike their active counterparts, few were offspring of members of the officer corps. Once commissioned, reserve officers had to continue to meet the army's standards in both their private and public lives. This meant avoiding contact with undesirable social elements, including political parties opposed to the government or hostile to the army. The military cabinet reserved the right to dismiss anyone it deemed unsuited for continued service. Not even good political connections could compensate for shortcomings in this area. The most famous example of a reserve officer losing his commission was Prince Heinrich of Schoneich-Carolat, who was dismissed in 1885, after revealing that he had supported Liberal Party representative Eugen Richter when the latter opposed the army in the Reichstag on a budget matter. He was not alone in losing his commission, and the military cabinet's oversight clearly extended beyond active duty to nearly all reserve officers. Social prestige. Officers willingly, even eagerly, accepted these arbitrary limitations, because of the enormous social prestige attached to a reserve commission. Many high-ranking civil servants maintained their reserve ranks and wore their uniforms on numerous occasions because of the elite status it automatically conferred. Chancellors Bismarck, Bülow, and Michaelis wore their uniforms on occasion, as did some prominent members of the Reichstag. Upon retirement or attainment of a venerated age and status, some distinguished political and governmental leaders preferred to be acknowledged with reserve commissions, even honorary, rather than high civilian titles. The reserve officer system eventually became one of the most controversial aspects of the Prussian military system. Because the educated middle classes accepted the system and coveted their reserve commissions, a number of historians have seen the institution as the final surrender of German liberalism to the militarism of the Prussian monarchy. Some have cited the militarization of the middle classes, but this cannot properly be attributed to the reserve officer system, which simply did not involve a sufficient number of individuals to have this effect. Nevertheless, the reserve officer system, if compared to the circumstances in 1848 and other developments before the Roon reforms, certainly reflected the fact that much of the upper middle class was ideologically aligned with the king and his officer corps. Patriotism and religion. Even in the increasingly secular intellectual climate of the 19th century, the Prussian monarchy continued to pay at least lip service to the old principle of the divine right of kings. Wilhelm I, for his part, definitely continued to believe in this medieval concept, and officers frequently adopted attitudes of obsequious obeisance that, however appropriate in the days of Frederick Barbarossa, seem somewhat out of place in the days of Marx, Darwin, and Freud. Kissing the royal hand, whether gloved or otherwise, was a not uncommon occurrence, even on the part of such hard-bitten officers as August von Mackensen. Of course, The practical aspects of using religion to support the established order were far more widespread than this ancient curiosity. The School of the Nation. As a result of its sometimes blind loyalty to the monarchy, the army proclaimed its lack of involvement in politics. This was an entirely false front, however, even though many have fallen prey to this illusion. The army's literature exhibited extensive efforts to promote the government's conservative political, social, and cultural values. This had not always been the case. The Napoleonic-era reformers conceived the concept that the army should be the nation's school for values, Erziehungsschule der Nation. They hoped that universal military service would enable the army to instill national consciousness and patriotism among the masses. The liberal idealism of the reformers quickly gave way to the more pragmatic concerns of Prussia's increasingly conservative military and political leaders. The concept of a school of the nation increasingly meant instilling new recruits with loyalty to the monarchy and the Prussian state, respect for established authority and religion, and hostility to the ideas of democracy and later socialism. Hans von Beseler, an officer of middle-class origins who was later raised to the nobility, wrote, "Militarism is the spirit of obedience and discipline, self-denial and loyalty until death. One of the most important and most serious tasks of the professional soldier is to transfer this soldierly spirit to the entire nation through the school of the army, and thereby expand and further the great work of educating the people." Although such statements have been subjected to harsh criticism and even ridicule among modern historians, many Prussian officers of all types, from the reserved intellectual Moltke to the unsophisticated field commanders, took the idea very seriously. Helmut von Moltke informed the Reichstag in February 1874 that it was not the schoolmaster who had won Prussia's battles, but the military profession as popular educator, which had for nearly 60 years trained the nation for bodily activity and moral health, to order and exactness, to loyalty and obedience, to love of fatherland, and to manliness. Another officer, writing in 1888, informed his comrades of their obligation to serve as educator, to fill their recruits with loyalty to the king, honour and duty, a sense of order, lawfulness, love of fatherland, and respect for God. The Prussian army made no secret of its goal of instilling conservative and patriotic values into its recruits, and through them the entire nation. The concept was, as one author has argued, a battle concept, the answer to the middle classes' struggle against the standing army from the period after the Napoleonic Wars to the end of the 19th century. Christianity. Recently, scholars have cast doubt on the importance of religion in the army, arguing that the officer corps was more secular than previously portrayed by historians. The evidence is equally strong, however, that many powerful and influential officers took religion very seriously. Wilhelm I was a devout Christian, as were numerous important officers. Whatever the personal piety of officers, the army incorporated religious services and messages into its ceremonies on numerous occasions. Wilhelm II's speeches at the annual swearing-in ceremonies to administer the royal oath to the Guards Corps were virtual sermons. The Kaiser manoeuvres typically had scheduled religious services, complete with prescribed uniforms. The army had Protestant chaplains throughout the 19th century and Catholic priests from 1852. Normal procedures required, at least in theory, that every soldier attend church services at least one Sunday per month, and the army instructed its officers to allow their men to attend as often as they wished, consistent with duty requirements. Officers accompanied their soldiers to obligatory church services on Sundays, and regarded religious activities as part of their official duties. There can be no doubt that the army aggressively used Christianity as a weapon against social democracy, and as a tool, with questionable success, to increase the soldiers' devotion to the king, the state, and conservative social values. Anti-Catholicism. Despite a paternalistic interest in its enlisted Catholics, the Prussian Army's officer personnel policy was strongly anti-Catholic. A cabinet order by Friedrich Wilhelm III had forbidden Prussian officers from promising to raise their children as Catholics, even though that was a condition of marriage to a Catholic woman. General Willibald von Arndt, the grandson of Ernst Moritz Arndt, was reputedly denied a corps command because he allowed his children to be raised as Catholics. Hermann von Treskow, who served as chief of the military cabinet from 1864 until 1871, was well known for his hatred of Catholics, who constituted about one-third of Prussia's population. The Catholic political leader Matthias Erzberger estimated in 1912 that 16% of the officer corps was Catholic, a figure roughly equivalent to the percentage of Catholics occupying the important administrative position of Landrat. Erzberger's estimate, though credible because of the source, was probably far too high. Although the necessity of acquiring a large number of junior officers forced the army to commission Catholics, very few rose to high rank. For the empire as a whole, only about 5% of the army's general officers were Catholics. Many of these men were special cases, coming from families with particularly good connections or long military traditions. The rise of the Catholic Center Party in the Reichstag gave Prussian officers, from the emperor down, new reasons to identify Catholicism with the enemies of Prussia and the new German Empire. Although Wilhelm I had attempted to avoid religious controversy in the officer corps during the Kulturkampf, and had appointed Catholic Freiherr von Löhe as an adjutant, he was deeply distrustful of Catholics. His grandson was less reserved. In some of his tirades, he questioned the loyalty of Catholic officers, a nearly unprecedented public act by the head of the ruling house. From chiefs of the general staff to various field commanders, the surviving statements of many luminaries of the Prussian officer corps provide ample evidence that prejudice against Catholics was alive and widespread well into the 20th century. Anti-Semitism. One aspect of the Prussian army's conservative Protestantism was its strong anti-Semitism. Although the army frequently gave commissions to young men whose family backgrounds were less than perfect, and it allowed strong personal attributes in one area to overcome deficiencies in other areas, there was one blemish that could not be overcome. With perhaps a single exception in the period 1820 to 1848, practicing Jews could not serve as officers in the Prussian army. The few baptized Jews who received commissions during the war against France in 1870 to 1871 were not fully accepted even during wartime, and were ruthlessly and quickly eliminated after the war's conclusion. The reaction of Ernst Baron von Amelungzen to the proposal to grant a battlefield commission to a Jewish non-commissioned officer was probably typical. Captain, later General, Amelungzen denied such a request because, as a Christian, he could not be responsible for placing a Jew in command of his soldiers. Jews served, of course, as enlisted men and even as one-year volunteers, although the latter were rarely given commissions as reserve officers. Indeed, by 1900, Jewish spokesmen had given up their efforts to open the active officer corps to practicing Jews, and concentrated instead on gaining access to reserve commissions. In this they enjoyed little success. Perhaps as many as 30,000 Jews served as one-year volunteers between 1885 and 1910, but hardly more than 300, all baptized, received reserve commissions. By 1914, there were no Jewish officers on active duty, and probably very few in the reserves. Throughout the 19th century, the army's anti-Semitism was primarily religious and cultural, although racial anti-Semitism made rapid inroads in some segments of German society around the turn of the century. The army on occasion gave commissions to men from Jewish families that had converted to Christianity. Numerous officers wrote comments in their memoirs and letters indicating their belief that Jews could not be full members of a Christian state, or that their involvement in liberal, democratic, or socialist causes led to suspicions of disloyalty. A few Jews, whose families had converted to Protestantism, may have received commissions and become generals. Probably the best-known examples were Reinhold von Mosner and Otto Liemann von Sanders. Mosner's father, a wealthy banker and landowner in Silesia, had been a personal friend of Wilhelm I. Mosner married into the Uradel Wolfersdorf family, gained a title of nobility as a major in 1890, and served as an aide to Wilhelm II. His personal connections to the Hohenzollerns and his personal background thus compensated for his Jewish origins, but few were in a position to duplicate his success. Sanders, famous for his exploits in Turkey, was also a special case. His grandfather had converted to the evangelical faith, his father was a large East Elbian landowner, and his wife was the daughter of a Prussian officer. Sanders was therefore not a Jew by the religious or social definition of the Prussian army. Jews were occasionally present on the periphery of the Prussian army in two ways. Academics of Jewish background occasionally held teaching positions at the War Academy. Wealthy Jewish women sometimes became military wives, and thus rescued impecunious nobles from their financial straits in exchange for respectability. One officer who acquired a Jewish wife for that purpose referred to her as his change purse. Such marriages occurred in all kinds of units, from provincial artillery to Berlin Guards regiments. Courts of Honour. Few institutions of the Prussian army better reflected its continuing aristocratic, some would say feudal, core than courts of honour and duelling. Both illustrated the officer corps' insistence that its sense of honour went far beyond that applicable to most segments of the population, and that courts of honour and duelling were essential for proper gentlemen to protect their good names and reputations. In 1906, War Minister Karl von Einem informed the Reichstag that as long as duelling was recognised by wide circles as a means of rehabilitating one's honour, the officer corps would not tolerate within its ranks anyone who was not willing to defend his honour with weapon in hand. Special courts of honour for officers, the Ehrengerichte, formally came into existence early in the 19th century and continued until they were outlawed under Article 105 of the Weimar Constitution. Military reformers convinced the king to issue the Regulation Concerning Punishment of Officers in August 1808. That regulation made the officer corps responsible for policing itself in matters related to the honour of any individual officer or the entire officer corps. If any one officer had seemingly compromised the honour of the whole officer corps, the regulation called for the creation of a court of honour consisting of officers drawn from the subject's regiment. A new order in 1821 gave courts of honour more definite form, and made the officer corps responsible for the conduct of its members. Each regiment subsequently established a standing commission to consider relevant cases. A new regulation dealing with courts of honour, revised in 1874, provided the essential feature of the system that existed through the First World War. Each regiment established its own court of honour, usually consisting of 10 officers, as did corresponding naval units. Separate courts were established for company grade and field grade staff officers. General officers were not subject to courts of honour. Separate courts of honour governed the conduct of medical officers in the army and navy. Members of the courts were elected for one-year terms and were authorised to consider any matters that might compromise the honour of the officer corps or that might lead to a duel between officers. The authority of the courts of honour extended to all active and reserve officers, officers à la suite of the army, officers of the gendarmerie, retired officers, and any others holding commissions that allowed them to wear the uniform. The 1874 regulation extended the system to the armies of Bavaria, Saxony, and Württemberg. In theory, regimental adjutants were the coordinating officers for courts of honour, but at the division and corps level, The senior general staff officer was usually the chief person administering the regulation. Concluding remarks. Armies do not spring into being overnight. In this respect, the army of the Kaiserreich was no exception. The army was based on Prussian institutions, some of which dated from the Napoleonic era. Others went back to the 18th century, if not further. These institutions were incorporated into the imperial system for reasons both domestic and foreign. Domestically, the army constituted one of the pillars that supported the conservative social and political order envisioned by Bismarck and other founders of the empire. Although in some cases almost archaic in appearance, these institutions proved remarkably flexible and adaptive, able to accommodate to some degree the societal changes that occurred in Germany during the pre-war period. Aside from the issue of monarchy, the army's principal purpose was to defend the empire against its foreign enemies. In the context of the imperial era, this meant France and possibly Russia. Here also, some of the institutions that underpinned the army proved capable of adapting to the demands of modern war. The military cabinet and the general staff were generally able to get the right commanders and chiefs of staff to the right place at the right time. The most famous example was the duumvirate of Paul von Hindenburg and Erich Ludendorff, although there were others. The reserve and Landwehr components met the test of war in 1914, achieving better results than their French and Russian opponents. Perhaps the greatest failure among the institutions of the Imperial Army was that of the Emperor. He was the unifying force, vested with the power of decision, or at least influence, over military matters. The constitution that outlined the Kaiser's powers had arguably been written with the tacit assumption that whoever occupied the office would have considerable military experience. This certainly applied to the first two rulers of the Kaiserreich, Wilhelm I and Friedrich III. But Wilhelm II was lacking in this area. His only military experience was at the regimental level, and even that was laden with artificialities. Although not a stupid man, Wilhelm II lacked intellect. His intelligence and mercurial personality were not tempered by a combination of rigorous education and extensive experience at a variety of levels. Thus, although he was capable of the occasional shrewd insight, Wilhelm's statements and opinions too often left high civilian and military officials doubtful of his judgment. To everyone's relief, Wilhelm II promised that, in the event of war, he would remain out of military matters. This ensured, however, that the head of state and commander-in-chief of the army would be a passive wartime observer at best. Although institutions are organizations, they are ultimately composed of people with a combination of different and similar experiences who share a common ethos and intellectual perspective. For the army of the Kaiserreich, the most important common intellectual perspective was its theory of war. This theory, underpinned by extensive historical analysis, was most fully developed by Karl von Clausewitz, the great Prussian theorist and Napoleonic-era soldier. After Clausewitz's death in 1831, the torch was passed to Count Helmut von Moltke in the 1850s. It is to these men and their concepts that we now turn. Chapter 2. The Prussian Theory of War, from Clausewitz to Moltke. The years from 1789 to 1815 saw important, indeed revolutionary, changes in Europe. The French Revolution transformed the social and political structure of France and introduced the germ of further radical change throughout the continent. Changes in social structure produced a vast transformation in warfare, while the God of War, as Clausewitz called Napoleon, conducted spectacular but unsuccessful efforts to extend his dominion across Europe. Other powers, particularly Prussia, reluctantly adapted to these changes, usually after crushing defeats. The cabinet wars of the 18th century gave way to the first of the truly national wars, as the surviving monarchs harnessed the full energies of their states to defeat the French threat. Important as this was, change in another field also had a significant impact. These years were also a time of intellectual transformation. The Enlightenment, which had set European intellectual development on a new path blazed by the earlier scientific revolution, gave way, particularly in Germany, to a new age in philosophy and politics. This new movement was essentially a counter-Enlightenment, directed against the rationalism of the philosoph. In the military realm, this emerging mixture of romanticism, historicism, nationalism, and other elements provided new ways of looking at the state and its military forces. It was the genius of Clausewitz that moulded this new intellectual outlook and changes in warfare into a new philosophy of war, which, however elusive in some respects and incomplete in others, laid the intellectual foundation of the emerging Prusso-German way of war. Although Clausewitz's classic book, On War, formed the basis of much of the Prussian theory of war throughout the period covered by this volume, other leading military intellectuals contributed importantly to the development of Prussian thought. This chapter begins with an examination of a few of these thinkers, both to establish the context and to indicate the nature of their important contributions. For instance, the ideas, battles, and writings of Frederick the Great occupied a prominent place in Prussian theory, even if he was questionably understood. Adam Heinrich von Bülow, 1757-1807, contributed numerous definitions that became prominent in later interpretations of Napoleonic warfare, even though he displayed no real understanding of the innovations of the French Revolution and Napoleon. Gerhard von Scharnhorst, 1755-1813, one of the key individuals in the reform of the Prussian state and its military system after the disastrous defeats at Jena and Auerstadt, contributed numerous basic ideas to Prussian military theory. They are logical starting points. Bülow pursued brief and largely unsuccessful careers in the Prussian army and various business enterprises before becoming a writer on a variety of subjects, military theory being the most prominent. His most important work, The Spirit of Modern Systems of War, 1799, laid out those ideas most relevant to this study. Like most Enlightenment theorists, Bülow saw warfare largely in mathematical terms, and was unable to escape the limits of this approach, even though he recognized some of the tactical innovations of his era. Claiming to be the founder of military science, Bülow argued that his geometric system of the base and the 90-degree angle guaranteed military victory to commanders who followed the scientific laws he had discovered. He even tried to explain Napoleon's early victories by reference to his formula. Ultimately, his argument that commanders should direct their efforts against the enemy's country rather than the army, and his emphasis on fixed magazines could not be reconciled with Napoleon's methods, but Bülow stuck to his approach in an increasingly erratic and sometimes belligerent manner. His most enduring contribution was in the area of terminology. He invented, or at least popularized, the concepts of the base and objective, and he may have been the originator of the concepts of strategy and tactics. His definitions, now obsolete, gave way entirely to those of Clausewitz, discussed next. Bülow adopted Henry Lloyd's concept of lines of operation, and in combination with his own mathematical ideas, used it as the basis of his theory. These concepts, along with the idea of the base of operations, have endured. Clausewitz first criticized this approach in 1805 in an anonymous article in the military journal Neue Bellona, and since then, most writers have regarded Bülow's writings as curious anachronisms associated with a bygone era. Bülow became associated with what most German military theorists regarded as outmoded ideas of victory, through reliance on maneuver and the mathematical forms of the late 18th century. The Prussian government, enraged by Bülow's prediction of French hegemony in Europe, declared him insane and imprisoned him in Kolberg and later Riga, where he came under Russian control. He died in prison in 1807, possibly from mistreatment. Scharnhorst, born of relatively humble origins in the Kingdom of Hanover, made a series of highly important contributions to the fundamentals of Prussian-German military thought and practice. Widely known for his military writings while still a very young officer, Scharnhorst became the leading intellectual of the Prussian army immediately after his transfer from the Hanoverian army in 1801. Although he is best known for his contributions to the early establishment of the Prussian general staff system, Scharnhorst's legacy in other areas is equally important. His emphasis on professional military education and his treatment of war as an art rather than a science became trademarks of the Prussian system. Certainly he inspired many of Clausewitz's ideas, even though the latter fundamentally rejected the broader theories of Lloyd, the man who had inspired Scharnhorst. Scharnhorst's views on education, field manuals, regulations, military history, theory, strategy, combined arms, rotation of general staff officers between staff and field units, and many other practical points were echoed in the later writings of Clausewitz, Moltke, and Schlieffen. Perhaps his most important legacy in the realm of military theory was the impact he had on his most brilliant student, Clausewitz. Karl von Clausewitz. Karl von Clausewitz, born in 1780 to the son of a former officer in the army of Frederick the Great, entered Prussian service at the age of 11 as an officer candidate. He was captured by the French in the Jena campaign of 1806 and spent more than a year in genteel detention in France. Following his release in 1807, Clausewitz rejoined Scharnhorst and played an important, if publicly unnoticed, role in the reform of the Prussian army. He was the actual author of much of Scharnhorst's official correspondence over the next several years. He gained admission to the new general staff, served as an instructor of the new general war school, Allgemeine Kriegsschule, from 1810 to 1812, and tutored the Prussian crown prince. Refusing to accept Friedrich Wilhelm III's complete capitulation to Napoleon, Clausewitz joined those officers who resigned their commissions. He gained admission to the Tsar's service and served in a relatively minor position during the campaign of 1812. He returned to Germany in the service of the German Legion and played a key role in the rapid rearmament of Prussia's eastern provinces. Following Napoleon's final defeat, Clausewitz returned to Prussian service, but his subsequent career suffered from what the king and many others regarded as his disloyalty during Prussia's most desperate hours. The remainder of his military career was relatively uneventful, except for his writings, most of which were published after his death in 1831. The most important of these was On War, published in 1834. Although the manuscript was clearly unfinished, recent scholarship has argued that On War was much closer to a completed work than previously thought. Regardless of the status of its completeness when it was published, On War has become the classic study of war. Clausewitz's influence. A vast literature on Clausewitz has dissected his views from every conceivable angle, and arrived at widely divergent views about the extent and nature of his influence on Prussian and German theory and practice. One book studied his reception in the English-speaking world. Another historian argued that it is a joke to regard On War as a sort of Bible in the Prussian army, even though several 19th-century German writers used precisely that term to describe Clausewitz's influence. Peter Perret, one of the leading authorities, argued in 1965, quoting German officer and historian Max Jens, that On War had been widely read in the German army, but he seemed to back away from that conclusion 20 years later in an article in the revised Makers of Modern Strategy. The issue here is not merely how many officers actually read On War, but the extent of its influence on Prussian-German military theory and doctrine. Maverick military writer Wilhelm Rustow, writing in 1857, was perhaps the first to note that On War was frequently discussed but little read, a judgment that might fairly describe the general treatment of Clausewitz's writings up to the present day. Substantial evidence indicates that, through the 1840s, Clausewitz was not widely known among the public, and his name was almost entirely absent from scholarly encyclopedias and lexicons. But the evidence in the military literature is less definite. Griesheim's well-known published Lectures on Tactics, 1861, clearly recognised Clausewitz's importance. In three books published between 1841 and 1845, the now-forgotten Saxon officer Karl Pernitz used an imaginary posthumous exchange of letters with Clausewitz to argue points of military theory, and they elicited a reply by a Prussian general staff officer. This would hardly have been possible if Clausewitz had been completely obscure in military circles. The writings of Prince Friedrich Karl, dating to the period before 1860, show unmistakable signs of Clausewitz's ideas and even use some of his specific phrases. By the end of the 19th century, numerous officers argued that Clausewitz was the basis of German theory and strategic thought. As several historians have pointed out, Clausewitz's actual influence is difficult to measure with any precision. Others argue that Clausewitz's influence was limited to a few issues, including his emphasis on large-scale combat, the uniqueness of each situation, and the role of imponderable factors in war. A few historians, notably Herbert Rosinski and Gerhard Ritter, reached the opposite conclusion. The former wrote of On War's immense influence, while the latter repeated the words of Sigismund von Schlichting and others, indicating that the work was a Bible of German theory. By 1914, a number of authors had begun to criticise various parts of On War, and some have used these cases to deny Clausewitz's influence. Yet, as one officer-scholar pointed out more recently, this may be seen as a sign of Clausewitz's continuing impact, since dissenting authors felt it necessary to single out On War to justify their departure from its views, a practice that continues to this day. A careful examination of the military literature after the publication of Clausewitz's major work reveals that many of Clausewitz's most important concepts entered the thought of the Prussian army in two ways. First, many of Prussia's most influential military writers incorporated some of Clausewitz's basic concepts into their writings, usually, but not always, with specific references. Second, the writings and general staff work of Helmut von Moltke, which provided the foundation for German doctrinal publications throughout the second half of the 19th century and beyond the First World War, incorporated basic Clausewitzian concepts into Prussian theory. Here, it should be noted that many of the ideas of Clausewitz and Scharnhorst had become basic features of Prussian thought before being set forth in On War. The following section examines some of Clausewitz's most enduring theoretical points, including some very important ones the Prussian army did not wholly accept, but still occupied a central place in Prusso-German theory. Sources of Clausewitz's thought. Clausewitz seems to have been a product of one of the major intellectual and philosophical paradigm shifts of his day, the end of Enlightenment and the beginning of Romanticism. Although many profess to see a dialectical process in Clausewitz's writings, the leading scholars deny that his intellectual methods can be traced to Georg Hegel, or that he used the Hegelian method. Many writers see much evidence of Immanuel Kant's philosophy and of Romanticism throughout Clausewitz's approach. Clausewitz's writings stress the limits of reason and rationality in war, surely a sign that he favoured Kant's critique of reason. Certainly, Clausewitz had some contact with professors and others who popularized Kant's philosophy. Nevertheless, as Hugh Strawn warns, the link with Kant should not be taken too far, since many of the basic concepts of On War are not compatible with Kant's thought as developed in The Perpetual Peace. The most convincing analysis is that of Perret, who points out that even in his earliest writings, Clausewitz partook fully of Kant's rejection of the illusion of rationalism and replaced it with a consideration of the realities of human activity, unforeseen events, and chance. In this sense, Clausewitz drew heavily on contemporary theories of art that stressed free, unsystematic reasoning. The nature of war. Using the analogy of a duel between individuals, Clausewitz defined war simply as an act of force to compel our enemy to do our will. Physical force is the means, and the imposition of one's will is the object. Rendering the enemy powerless is the only certain means of attaining the object. War is thus the collision of two living forces. The contestants have two sources of power for this struggle, said Clausewitz, the total means at their disposal, and the strength of their wills. Clausewitz went on to point out that however extreme war might be in theory, in reality it can range from a struggle for extermination, Vernichtungskrieg, to simple armed observation, depending on the importance of the objectives being sought and the combatants' strength of will. Later, Book 1, Chapter 2, Clausewitz emphasized that wars frequently end short of total victory for either side, and that other reasons for terminating wars can emerge. In concluding his discussion of the nature of war, Clausewitz set forth his concept of the paradoxical trinity. War, in his view, has three primary tendencies that pull conflict in three directions, like three opposing magnets. 1. Violence, hatred, and enmity. 2. Chance and probability. 3. Subordination to policy. These, in turn, are related primarily to popular passions, the military instrument, and the government. Numerous subsequent writers, particularly in the American military and security communities, have confused the basic trinity with the three related elements of a society at war. In any case, the task Clausewitz set forth for the strategist was to find a theory that would balance these three tendencies. Although Clausewitz posited that war in theory consists of unrestrained violence aimed at the complete overthrow of the enemy.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.